Is the work world confusing? Congested? Are you just trying to find your way? There must be a light at the end of this tunnel. Well, there's a way to find your calling, to find that job you want and deserve, when someone will come up to you and say, "You're hired." Hi, I'm Steve Piazzale, a career and life coach, and welcome to Your Hired, a show about jobs and careers in which we answer questions such as, how do I find work that makes me come alive? How do I get that job I want and deserve? How do I juggle a couple of different careers and be successful at each? Well, we answer questions like that by having on the show knowledgeable, interesting guests, and we certainly have one today. Before I introduce him, I'd just like to invite you to check out the website, www.bayareacareercoach.com, to watch other episodes of the show and to find out about the career coaching I do. Again, that's www.bayareacareercoach.com. Well, we're welcoming Michael Krasny to the show, and I'm reading this because there's so much here. He's the host of the award-winning show Forum on KQED-FM. He's professor of English and Literature at San Francisco State, and the author of two excellent books, his memoir, Off Mic, and also a book on agnosticism called Spiritual Envy. He's won numerous awards for broadcasting excellence as well as for his extensive public service. And I told him when we were talking about his being on the show that interviewing Michael Krasny is a lot like playing catch with Willie Mays in his prime. It's exhilarating, but it's a little intimidating because you know you're dealing with the best. So I welcome you to the show.
Thank Michael you. Krasny. Delighted to be here.
And you did teach Willie Mays everything he knows, right? So
Willie lived on the streets, by the way.
Oh, that's right, with stickball. Yeah. Right? Yeah. This show is about jobs and careers and career arcs and how people made decisions. And so your first start or your first ambition, as I understand it, was to be a novelist. And so I was wondering if you could tell us how that came about and how you pursued it and then how it played itself out.
Actually, it was probably an ambition before that. I thought at one point maybe I wanted to be a physician and take up psychiatry because I thought that the only way I could really please my father was by getting a medical degree. But I found out soon enough in an anatomy class that it wasn't for me. And it wasn't so much that I was squeamish, it was just the smell of formaldehyde that was overwhelming. And also sort of falling in love with Shakespeare and literature, which happened to me as a young man. And as a result, I found myself moving along a scholarly track, but really doing it largely with the thought that I would teach and I would use teaching as sort of what many novelists did, as a way of at least putting food on the table and write novels. But I guess you're looking at a failed novelist. I mean, I didn't, Terry Gross, a colleague of mine at NPR, once said she just didn't hear the voices within her, and I didn't hear those voices either, though I tried. I really did struggle for years to try to write novels, and it was not my calling.
Is it still a possibility at some point, or is the bar set so high? I mean, look at the people that you've interviewed. Is the bar so high that there's a fear of even trying to do that at this point?
Or? I don't think it's a fear, and one should never rule out the possibility that something could happen and something will ignite and I'll be able to tell a tale that is worthy of the marketplace or just even worthy of setting down on paper. But I think what happened to me was pretty instructive in the sense that I realized that I was more of a reporter, scholar, journalist, you know, that those were the stories I had to tell. And those are the stories that I've been telling as a broadcaster, those are the stories that I've been telling as a writer, and they're factual, and they're, you know, research, and they're rooted in actuality. And I'm not saying that that's preferable, because I would wish that my imagination could have been galvanized to be the kind of novelist I aspire to being, but, you know, if you're playing in the minor leagues and you're looking at Willie Mays, and I wasn't necessarily looking at Willie Mays, but I was looking at people like Saul Bellow and William Faulkner and James Joyce, and realizing, you know, I wasn't in that class, so the bar was pretty high, but I really wasn't a novelist either. So.
Yeah, there was a great drummer named Buddy Rich. I really enjoyed his music and said Buddy Rich inspired millions to take up the drums and he inspired millions to quit. Because as soon as they started playing, they knew, this isn't as easy as I thought it might be.
That's a good example. In fact, you know, Flannery O'Connor said something to the same effects. He said there are all these aspiring young writers who really ought to take note of the fact that they may not have the gifts, they may not have the talents, and there are too many writers out there competing, trying to be writers who shouldn't be.
So talk about the role of teaching. I kind of want to go, we start with the novelist, the teaching, and then we'll go to radio and then print. But can you talk a little bit about the role teaching has played in having students and editing pieces? And
well, teaching has played a preeminent role in my life. I started out as a literature and composition teacher and have always been very committed to it, dedicated to it. Good department member and all that, and that seemed to me to be the life that would be appealing, to work with young people, to be in the classroom, also to write articles and do literary criticism, and for many years that was indeed my life. In fact, I started out, I happened to do a dissertation, PhD dissertation on an African-American writer, and I started out teaching, among other things, African-American literature, and it was one of the most exhilarating experiences of my life. I mean, it was a little scary at first, going to a classroom, this is San Francisco State, 1970, the year after a strike, after a strike that was propelled by black students and militant black students, and came into that situation, and I just said to them, I don't claim to be an insider here, I'm a scholar, and I think I can teach things to you as an outsider and as a scholar, and they were very welcome, and it was a wonderful experience. And then I began teaching a number of other courses that interested me. One of the wonderful things about being at San Francisco State was you could keep kind of reinventing different courses, and I did. Mm-hmm. I mean, I taught literary theory, I taught a course in Freud, I taught transatlantic literature. Well, things would interest me, and I taught a course called Literature and the Absurd, where I just used Camus and Sartre, the existential writers, and have them in conjunction with writers like Beckett and Ionesco and Edward Albee. Things that interested me, I could actually just go in the classroom and teach as long as I was prepared and I was ready to make the commitment. And so I've been at it for a number of decades now, and I still enjoy it, and I still feel committed to it, passionate about it. I still feel it's a calling.
Okay, then the next step was the radio that you've been part of, AM and FM, or public and commercial. Can you say something about each of those and the roles they've played? I remember from your book, it definitely seemed like Forum was the better forum for you than the more angular AM radio, but can you speak
to
that
a little bit? Well, I had luck in that sense. I mean, I was, go back to your baseball metaphor, I was working at a small station in San Rafael doing a talk show called KTIM. It doesn't exist anymore. And
that's the one where Jerry Garcia
You read my book.
Yes, I did. Yes.
Jerry Garcia did surprise me with a spoon that had some substance in it in the middle of an interview. But I was sort of summoned. Some people found out about my work there and took interest, and there was a whole big piece on me in the pink section. And it was a time when Marin County was getting a lot of attention. And I met Ron Owens, who subsequently got to know fairly well, and he actually used a baseball metaphor. He said, we have a great starting team, but we need a bench. Would you be willing to do some fill-in? I could talk to the program director and maybe get you a position here, because he'd heard my tapes on KTIM, and he thought, I'd done some work in television as well. Actually, I started not in radio, but in television, doing some political commentary for KTVU and doing a couple of interviews for KQED television. And then things sort of took off from there. I did some fill-in for KGO, which was the number one station and has been for many years. And then got my own program, KGO FM. They tried FM for a while, but it didn't really work. Part of it was the difficulty actually with reception, particularly in the hilly areas of San Francisco, with an FM talk station. And KGO was 50,000 watts, and it went all over at night. In fact, we were up in Canada and down in Mexico. And I liked commercial radio. I liked, I didn't like reading commercials, but I liked commercial radio and felt comfortable with it. But I was very divided. I mean, I was university professor. I was also a broadcast journalist. And I thought, how can I do both of these? It seemed like one should maybe cancel the other out. But I liked them both. I mean, most mm-hmm. people don't like their jobs, and I mm-hmm. had two jobs that I really liked, and I just stayed with them. I cut back my teaching, because in those days we had a four-course load anyway, and it was almost probably a kind of good fortune to not have that four-course load anymore and to be able to teach two classes instead, which I did and still do. And then things changed. That is, the marketing changed and the whole nature of the business changed.
They told you to amp it up a little more, huh?
Well, they amped it up a lot. You know, they decided they wanted to be sensational and tabloid and go for younger demographics, and they were getting nervous about not having enough for their advertisers. And, you know, they said to me, they'd been saying this to me all along, well, maybe you don't really belong here. You know, you're a little bit too scholarly, intellectual, whatever.
And, I thought you were going to say cerebral.
Well, that word was used as well. And I resisted that. I thought, oh, you know, they were probably right. But, you know, I thought, I mean, I was garnering a pretty good audience, and I liked what I did, and it seemed to make sense. I liked editorializing. I even liked sometimes ranting a bit, you know, when
oh,
I got...
Oh, really?
Yeah. Didn't do it that much, but I did some of it. And we went and parted ways, and it was just my good fortune that around that time, Kevin Persklov, who had been the host of Forum, left KQED. And as a result of that, they had a number of auditions. They went through a whole process of auditioning people, and I was lucky enough, I guess, and fortunate enough to...
And talented enough.
Well, anyway, they selected me. And I've been there now, it'll be 19 years this February, but it's been a much better fit in many ways.
Yeah.
So it was really, I mean, I was a bit crestfallen after I was let go from KGO. I thought, you know, I don't know where I'm going to bounce back here. I like radio, I want to stay in it, mm-hmm. and I don't know if there's a home for me. I'm obviously not cut out for kind of what you would call the high amp radio.
Yeah.
And it worked out for the best.
You probably can see both more than one side of most issues, and that's hard to, you know, be angular when you can see both sides.
I do have that curse or blessing, I think. But I should tell you that, and I take some no small amount of satisfaction in this. Since I've been at KQED, it's growing, and it's growing enormously. And I don't take any kind of lion's share credit. It's just a fact that. You know, we now have a news department, and we didn't when mm-hmm. I started. The Forum show has grown enormously, but the whole station has as well. As a result, now not only, and I'm sorry if this sounds like horn tooting, but not only is KQED the number one public radio station of all the NPR stations in the country, but it's also the number one station in the Bay Area market, which is really unprecedented for a public radio.
Yeah.
It says something about Bay Area listeners, perhaps more than anything else, that they would gravitate toward a public radio station and have it beat out all of the commercial stations.
Wow. Yeah. How about this next stage? In the last 5 years, you've come out with your own words, your own books, and they're excellent. Can you talk about the role that's played? These are your words now, not an interpretation of someone else. What role does that fill in your life?
A pretty big one. Because, as we've said, I wanted to be a novelist, and the kind of writing I've done does involve some imagination, but it's a lot of research, it's a lot of what I was trained for as a scholar, and, you know, I'd certainly done a lot of publishing, mainly in journals and magazines and things of that sort, but suddenly I found myself wanting to write a book, and I did with Off Mic, and then I did again with something that ignited in me, and... wrote Spiritual Envy, and now I'm in the throes of, or the thrall of, writing another book.
Oh, I was going to ask you that. Is that top secret with the topic?
I think I am going to have to keep it secret.
Well, maybe it'll be out.
Well, the problem for me with writing is, to be a real writer, you have to work every day, and mm-hmm. you have to be sort of, as Michael Chabon said to me, you have to get your butt in that seat and just do the work, and do it daily. And I'm more of a binge writer, you know. I find the time is, because my schedule is so glutted.
Yes.
I just can't write daily.
Yeah.
So I have to write when I can, sometimes weekends, sometimes when there's a vacation from school, that sort of thing. And it's a longer process for me, but, you know, it comes to birth.
So let me ask you about reinvention. In career coaching I do, career counseling, we talk about refashioning yourself. Sometimes your original dream doesn't work out, or you work a while in a field that becomes technically obsolete. you were, at least from the outside, it appears totally resilient to be able to land on your feet and generate three different careers, or at least two, and move forward, maybe with some regrets. Where does that come from? Do you think of it as reinvention or just survival, or how did you do that, that resilience? I think that would really be inspiring to viewers.
I don't know if I can inspire people, because I don't know if it's really that much reinvention. I think I see it as a kind of, and I hope this isn't disappointing to you or to your viewers, but I see it more as a kind of organic outgrowth almost. I taught and I honed some skills in the classroom, and you know, people who are thinking of a teaching career now are not nearly as fortunate as I was. I mean, it was still a buyer's market when I was out looking with a PhD for a professorship, and a tenured professorship is what I wanted and got, but certainly the world was very different than the one, let's say, that my parents grew up in, or their parents grew up in. The job started to constrict, and they've constricted even more in terms of the possibility, particularly, frankly, for, you know, white males. It's a very different world now. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to stay in school because I was fascinated by learning and wanted to learn.
And you still are, right?
I still am. I kept that curiosity incandescent and burning, fortunately. But I also was reckoning with the fact that, I mean, I remember watching interviewers and watching people who were doing news commentary, and I thought, gee, I could do that. I'd like to do that, you know? And I'm a pretty politically minded guy, and I thought, I'm a creature of the 60s, really, and I thought this all seems logical as a way to go. It's just how to find it. And there was some invention involved, admittedly, but I thought, if I can find a place, I can do this. And then a number of circumstances allowed for me to do some television, and then the move or metamorphosis or morphing or whatever into radio and so forth. But there was a definite interest and drive there that came out of just communication skills and the desire to see them at a different level or in a different venue and to ply them, really.
Mm-hmm. So in your case, it's more of an organic growth rather than a break from the past and a total reinvention.
I think so. Because I did one thing and then I did another, and then I still retained doing the thing. I remained a teacher, and still am a teacher, and had always been an aspiring writer. Had always done some writing, and so suddenly it seemed like a natural outgrowth for me to write books. Yeah. I mean, I'd written articles, I published a few stories, and that sort of thing. But suddenly, books were what I realized were more my métier and had been all along, and it was a natural kind of process. Yeah.
Slightly different question for you. You said once in an interview on YouTube that you feel fortunate because most people don't even have one career they love, and you said that you had three, which I assume included the writing.
Yeah.
And my question was, or is, do you love them in part because there are three of them? And that they have a synergy between them and they use different strengths you have? Or would you love them all separately if you were only a teacher or only a nonfiction writer or only a radio personality?
It's a good, thoughtful question. And I think the answer is that I love the cross-fertilization. I mean, that's how I describe it. That sounds a little bit, you know, too botanical or something, but it really works for me, because here I teach writers who I interview, for example, and it gives me a whole different dimension that I can bring into the classroom.
Oh, yeah.
And then I write about people I interview, and I write about, you know, the process of what I've done as a broadcaster and so forth. So they're all really crossing over in different ways into each other, and they're different forms of expression, they're different ways of being curious. And they allow for different sides of my personality in many respects, too. I mean, I can go in the classroom and... I can be, you know, very dramatic, for example, much more than I can as this broadcaster persona, which is, particularly in public radio, not necessarily attuned to histrionics or things of that sort, or to being a comedian, which I like to do.
Oh, that's right.
Too.
Yeah, you've got a good sense of humor.
So it allows a kind of protean quality. It allows for a sort of mercurial quality that I rather fancy, and I find is constantly stimulating. I used to joke and say it serves my neurosis to spread myself thin like this, but there's some truth to that, too.
Actually, it leads right into the next question. More and more people are, as part of their career, they have like a portfolioed career, what we call, you know, they're doing several things at once. Mm-hmm. And my question for you is, how do you maintain the standard of excellence that you that you achieve in three different careers? I mean, do you have some advice you can give somebody who's trying to do more than one thing and not let any of the balls drop? How have you been able to be as effective as you are in
all
three?
It's nice of you to talk about efficacy and excellence. I appreciate that.
Well, I believe it.
Well, kind of you, generous of you. I just try to do the best I can do at what I do, and it's always, for me, a challenge, and I suppose I have a good work ethic and conscientiousness about what I do. I want to be certain that the work is quality work and that I'm well prepared. I mean, I think a lot of people, for example, listen to the radio. Just to use this as a singular example, because I've learned this through the years, if a teacher comes in as prepared, you notice the preparation, mm-hmm. and you presumably can almost take by osmosis the fact that there's been a lot of preparation if you're a student in the classroom. You know when a teacher is not prepared, certainly. But a lot of people listen to, for example, broadcasters, and they don't know that there's also sometimes a pretty assiduous form of preparation that goes into it, you know. And there's no trick to this. I mean, if you have a good support system and you work with people who feed you and who particularly talking about broadcasting now and editors and publishers and things of that sort, if you're wise enough and lucky enough to get people, and I have been very fortunate in that case, working with producers who have been first rate, working with editors who have been terrific and that sort of thing. Teaching is different, though, because teaching, you're just kind of unharnessing your own abilities, and especially in university teaching, you're on your own, and before you get tenure, they monitor you and they come in and do classroom evaluations and that sort of thing, but for the most part, you're your own inner judge.
So you have to have the inner drive yourself.
Absolutely. That's right.
Yeah. Okay. This is a big question. You raised the question, or it's actually Saul Bellow's question, how should a good man live or a good person live? What role does career play in answering that question for you?
Plays a pretty significant one. I thought you were going to ask me a question that I was going to shy away from, which is how should a good man live? I've been wrestling with that for many years, but I think
if you want to answer that way, you could. I'm just staying with career.
No, I think everything I do involves some public service, and it involves a sense of being an educator. I mean, if you're a writer, if you're a scholar, if you're a broadcaster doing the kind of broadcasting I do, or a teacher, your job is to some extent to bring light and knowledge. I mean, that's really what my life has been about, and there's public service in that, because when you bring light and knowledge, you hope you're bringing good citizenship, you hope you're achieving some sense of bringing up the level of discourse, making people realize sort of the multidimensionality of many issues, because that's what we do certainly in public radio. And public radio particularly began as an educational mission behind it. Mm-hmm. So here I am, an educator in a classroom, and I'm an educator on the airwaves. I used to talk about my program as being kind of a university of the airwaves, and I liked that idea because it's not just literature, it's everything, really. News, public affairs, but also, we do technology, we do science, we do business, we do anything that's newsworthy, and we have people who write books from every imaginable walk of life or subject. So I tell myself that I'm doing some good. And certainly I like to hope that that is indeed the case. And because I'm a public figure, I'm often asked to do many events where I can also fulfill that role and do things for many nonprofits, as I guess you are well aware. I mean, mm-hmm. I probably do too much sometimes, it seems, because it takes me away from living a life. it's a pretty jam-packed and crazy schedule sometimes, but it's also something I enjoy.
I think you've already answered my next question, which is, in Spiritual Envy, you talked about building your own personal code, and I was curious how that informs the career decisions you've made, but I think you just answered that, right? Or is it slightly different? Does your personal code help you make decisions about what to do next?
It does now, but I think I had to figure all that out. I mean, I was just doing things that I liked, and then I had to realize that I was liking them in part because of the satisfaction and pride and feeling that I was doing worthwhile things. I mean, sometimes you have to discover that sort of without even necessarily knowing that you're going into something you go into something and it gives you pleasure and it tests your skills and all of that, and then you discover in the process that you're maybe making impact on people's lives and doing some good. I mean, that was really the case for me. There are certainly people who, you know, would like to probably see somebody else in my role. anybody in a public role like I have with as many listeners as I have isn't going to have everybody like them or like their style or anything. But you get enough feedback that it really makes a difference, and you realize you are making a difference.
You spoke at Google a few years ago when your book came out, and
I actually talked there with both books.
Okay, well, yeah. The one that it was off mic was the one I was thinking of, and this person stood up and said that originally he was an artist and now he's doing technical work. And did you have a reaction to his not, you know, the art that's lost for him? And you quoted or told the story of a guest you'd had on your show who was a psychotherapist who ended up being a painter in her 70s. Mm-hmm. And a quite successful one. And you said something I just loved, and I thought maybe you could expand on it. You said, never think of that your dreams are in the dust. Never think that your dreams are in the dust. It's moving, and I think that...
I don't even remember that, but it has a kind of poetic touch I like, actually, so thanks for bringing it up.
Can you expound on that? I mean, is it...
Well, the woman you're talking about is a woman named Lillian Rubin, who has written many books and who's actually a pretty good friend of mine. And now she's in her 80s, actually, and she's a remarkable woman. I mean, first of all, if you saw her, you'd never know that she was in her 80s to begin with. But she's also very smart, very capable, and has written for years not only books but articles and tomes, in fact. And suddenly she just decided she wanted to reinvent herself and learn painting. And you know, the fact that she succeeded, not only, I mean, what I was struck by, I think, probably at the time, was not only her success, but the fact that if people want to be a painter, you know, and they're in their 80s, or why not? I mean, and you don't have to succeed. You know, Lillian was, there was a talent there that was obviously buried or submerged or subterranean that came out, but there's no necessity to give up on anything. If you want to do it, do it. You know, it's... It's funny, when I said that, I thought of all those books in the 60s, including, I think there was a book by Jerry Rubin, you know, called Do It, meaning radical activity and all that sort of thing. I'm just thinking now about the possibility on an existential level of just following whatever ignites inside of you, whatever you want to do.
Where does the drive for excellence come from? I mean, it seems like you prepare, you put yourself on the line, you... Obviously, with agnosticism, it's not for some external reward. It's, but you're really intense, and you do what you need to do. Where does that drive come from, or is it just something that it's
drive has always been a bit mysterious to me, Steve. I mean, I don't really pretend to understand it, but I think it certainly. I've done enough self-reflection and therapy and all that I know that it comes out of a lot of my experiences, and it comes out of need to prove the self to the self. David Riesman, Harvard sociologist, who I read when I was pretty young, made the difference between outer-directed people and inner-directed people.
Yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
It's a useful dichotomy. I think in some ways, as I've gotten older, I've been more inner-directed, which I think is maybe healthier in some ways. But as a young man, particularly, I was very outer-directed. I wanted approval. And it's still part of my DNA, I suspect, and it can drive you. But what really ought to drive you, and what really does drive me, is myself, is my own high standards, I hope.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that leads to all the preparation that you do, and the you're just totally on top of it every time you're interviewing somebody.
Not totally on top of it,
sure,
not by any stretch,
it.
But I am prepared. I mean, there you can put, like, the Boy Scouts on my tombstone. He was prepared. He did his homework. I mean, I used to have a kind of boilerplate joke that when Larry King was around doing broadcasting, people would say, well, you always read the book, and Larry King makes almost a fetish out of never reading the book. And I said, yeah, that's why he's rich and famous. But I think there may even be some truth to that.
Our time is up. It flew by. I have many more questions for you. Thank you so much
for
being on the show.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
And thank you for watching You're Hired. If you have any questions for us about this show or suggestions for future shows, questions about jobs and careers, feel free to email me at steve@bayareacareercoach.com. And do check out the website. We have the previous episodes on the show. We have contact information. You can find out more about Forum and the books. We can get it at a local bookstore or online with Amazon.com. And that's all at www.bayareacareercoach.com. And your website is KQED.
Just go to kqed.org and you'll find out about the radio program. And I have a michaelkrasny.com, too, website. But I hope this has been useful for your viewers.
Yeah, I think so. Thanks for watching, and we'll catch you next time on You're Hired. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. So you have one more question?